Hello, and welcome to Azure Kubernetes Service Best Practices Series. In this session, we will discuss cluster management and multi-tenancy in Kubernetes. This is an intermediary level session, so you are expected to have familiarity with the basic Kubernetes concepts. My name is Mohammad Nofal. I am a solution architect in the Azure Global Black Belt team. My role is focused on enabling Kubernetes in the enterprise and web scale organizations. So what's on our agenda for today? First, cluster isolation patterns. One of the top questions we get from our customers is how many clusters should I have? Or how should I isolate my workloads within the same cluster? So part one from the session will be discussing the isolation patterns. Then I'll explain scheduling and resource management in Kubernetes and how you can make sure your pods are not contending for resources. Finally, we will end with a demo. So let's get started. There are two isolation patterns that you can use in Kubernetes. The first pattern is physical isolation, in which you dedicate clusters based on the environment, like dev or staging, or cluster per team, or cluster per project. So each workload is contained within its own cluster. In this example, we have two clusters, one for dev and one for staging. And in production, we have two clusters for team one and team two. The second isolation pattern is the logical isolation. In logical isolation, you typically group workloads in clusters based on some commonalities between them, like the environment, the team, or criticality of the workload. In this example, we have two clusters, one cluster for both dev and staging workloads, where you have different teams sharing the same cluster. Then the second cluster is dedicated for production workloads, where you have three teams in it. So what enables us to divide or subdivide our clusters in such a way that is safe, secure, and efficient? We are going to use Kubernetes namespaces as our logical isolation boundary. Just a quick note for those who don't know, Kubernetes namespaces is an object that allows you to create a virtual cluster within your cluster. Namespaces provide scope for names, so you can use the same name for objects like pods or services across different namespaces. Also, we need to be aware that not everything is namespaced. For example, nodes are not namespaced as of the recording of this session. Now, we have multiple workloads or teams coexisting in the same cluster. To safely isolate these workloads from each other, there are four different areas that we need to consider. First thing to think of is scheduling. We need to protect the cluster compute resources, and we need to make sure that pods are not contending for them. This is where resource quotas and some other Kubernetes features come in handy. This will be the focus of this session. Then we need to think of the network isolation. Kubernetes has a flat network by default, which means that any pod can access any other pod even across different namespaces. To prevent this from happening, you will need to use Kubernetes network policies, which is a way to secure pod-to-pod communication by applying network security policies on group of pods based on their levels. The other area that we need to consider is to make sure that the access to the Kubernetes API is protected and only authenticated and authorized identities can interact with the cluster. This can be achieved by using Kubernetes RBAC with Azure Active Directory integration, pod identity, secrets encryption, and some other features. Lastly, you need to protect your containers in order to make sure that a compromised container will not result in an elevated access to the nodes. You need to consider things like scanning the container images against your organization security baseline. You need to scan the containers during runtime. There are some Linux features that you can consider, like AppArmor and SE Linux, and some others that you can leverage to accomplish this. The focus of this session will be only on the scheduling part. Network and security related topics will be discussed in other sessions. So now let's delve deeper into resource management in Kubernetes. First, we will discuss resource quotas. Resource quotas is a way to assign resource limits to namespaces. With resource quotas, you can assign compute resource limits like CPU, memory, disk, etc. on your namespaces. And you can assign object limits like team X can only create 100 pods in this namespace. When you apply resource quotas on namespaces, only deployments that satisfy the quota requirements and policy will pass. Otherwise, if the deployment doesn't advertise resource quota, it will fail and a 403 forbidden error will be returned as violation for the quota constraints. Here on the right, we have an example for a resource quota manifest. Its name is mem-cpu-demo, and it has requests for one CPU and 1 GB of RAM. A request is what will be reserved and guaranteed for the namespace. Then it has a limit of for 2 CPUs and 2 GB of RAM. A limit is what we can burst to, assuming we have resources available in the cluster. Now let's discuss limit range, which is an admission controller. An admission controller, for those who don't know, is a piece of code that intercepts requests to the Kubernetes API server prior to persistence of the object. It does a couple of things. It either validates the request, mutate the request, or both validate and mutate. In the resource quotas, we discussed that by applying them to namespaces, all deployments that do not advertise resource quotas will fail. Now, if you don't want to be that aggressive, you can use the limit range admission controller, which will apply default limits to pods that do not specify any. On the example on the right, any pod with no memory resource quotas advertised will be assigned 256 meg as guaranteed and burst up to 512 of memory. Limit range is loaded by default in AKS, and all you have to do is to configure your own policies. Moving on, pod disruption budget is a way to protect our deployment from voluntary actions. Voluntary actions are actions performed by an admin or automation, like draining a node, removing a pod, or scaling down operations. Pod disruption helps you decide the number of pods that can be down simultaneously from a voluntary disruption. In the example on the right, we are applying a pod disruption budget policy that says my Nginx deployment that has the label Nginx-PDB should at least have 90% of its pods available. Which means if I have 10 pods, I can tolerate the failure only of one. Finally, note that pod disruption budget doesn't protect from involuntary actions like node failure or shutdown. Node selectors. Now, if you have an application with specific requirements, for example, GPU workload, and you need it to be deployed on the GPU nodes only, you can use node selectors for this purpose. With node selectors, you label the node, as in our example in the right, hardware GPU, and in your pod manifest, you can say that this pod will only land on the node that has the hardware GPU label. When using node selectors, the pod will only be able to be deployed when there are nodes with the label and they have capacity. Otherwise, the pod will fail to deploy. You should note that node selectors are not hard rules, which means other pods with no node selector can still land on the node. Node affinity is a successor for node selector, but it introduces soft rules. Required during scheduling, ignored during execution, which is a hard rule, just like the node selectors. And then the second one, preferred during scheduling and ignored during execution, is the soft one, which means that if you don't have capacity, try to place the pods on some other nodes that do not have the label. We recommend using node affinity over node selectors. enter pod affinity and anti-affinity. It's similar to the node affinity, but now we can specify where should my pod land based on the labels of already existing pods. For example, I need my front-end pod to land on the nodes where my back-end pods are. It also has the same rules as node affinity. So now let's move to the demo section. In this demo section, we're gonna create a namespace, apply a resource quota on this namespace, deploy another or deploy a container beyond limits that will fail, deploy a simple container within the limits and this should pass. Then apply a limit range policy on this namespace and then test the limit range policy. So now let's create a namespace called cm-webinar. If I describe this namespace, I can see that there are no resource quotas or limits announced in this namespace. Let's change the default namespace to the newly created one. Now, I need to apply a resource quota to this namespace, and this is the manifest that I'm using. In this manifest, I'm requesting for one CPU and 1 gig of memory, and my limits equal to my request, which means that I'll be not able to burst in this namespace. Right, the policy was applied. If I describe the namespace again, I can see that the resource quotas started to be tracked. Now let's create a pod that has no resource limits advertised in it. And this is the pod manifest that I'll be using. Right. And I can see that the pod deployment has failed because I'm violating the quota constraints. And if I look at the pod manifest, VS Code is already warning me that I'm not announcing limits in my pod manifest. And this was enabled using the Kubernetes extension for VS Code, which is highly recommended to use. Now let's deploy a deployment that has resource limits in it. Right, I can see that it passed. Let's check the manifest for this deployment. This is the manifest, it's an Nginx deployment. It has 4 replicas in it. And then each replica is asking for 250 meg of RAM and a quarter of CPU and same for the limits. If I get the pods, then I can see that I got the 4 all applied or deployed. If I describe the namespace, I can see now that the used equal to the hard, which means that I cannot deploy more in this namespace. So let's delete the deployment. Now, Kubernetes will, after the deletion of deployment, will claim back the resources to my namespace. So if I describe the namespace again, I can see that 3 pods already were terminated. As such, I have 250 meg left. This number will be 0 once the last pod was deleted or terminated. So now let's apply a limit range policy to this namespace so we don't fail the deployments that have no resource limits in them. Right, and this is the manifest that I used. And in this manifest, I'm just saying that if there is no limit, then apply a default limit of 300 meg of memory and then 0.5 CPU. And then the request will default to 256 meg of RAM and a quarter of CPU. If I describe the namespace again, I can see that resource quotas are tracked and then newly now resource limits are being tracked too. So let's create a pod that has no limit. This is the pod that I'm using, right? It has no limits announced in it. And I can see that it passed. If I describe the pod, I can see that the pod was assigned default limits and requests, which was applied from the limit range policy, which is quite handy. And this sums up our demo. Let's go back to our presentation. Just a quick note. Now, if you want to scan your cluster to see if you have pods with no resource quotas applied, you can use KubeAdvisor, which is a pod that scans your cluster and reports pods with missing resource quotas. That's the current implementation. In the future, more features will be added. For more information, you can access the link here. The tool is open source and contributions are welcome. During the demo, I showed that if you have a pod or a deployment with resource quotas missing, VS Code will warn you against this. You can get this if you are using the Kubernetes extension for VS Code. So what to use, physical or logical isolation? Below, I'll try to summarize the pros and cons for each option so you can make an informed decision. First, pod density. In logical isolation, you can dense more pods as you have more users and better visibility. While on physical isolation, you're gonna end up with some underutilized clusters since not most of the teams or workloads will be utilizing their clusters to the fullest. When it comes to cost, physical isolation is typically higher because of the underutilized resources. Now, from Kubernetes experience perspective, a logical isolation requires more experience, as you have to apply all the isolation and security controls day one for your production workloads to make sure that it's safe. While on physical isolation, you've got isolation for free. This doesn't mean that you don't have to apply security controls, but it means that you have time to do it. On security, both are high, and in both you need the same security controls. Physical has an advantage over the logical, as you have a smaller surface, while on logical, you have a bigger surface. Hence, you need to be more strict in your security controls from the very beginning. On the blast radius of changes, we just discussed the smaller surface. As such, physical has a smaller blast radius, which make cluster level changes easier and more manageable. The management and operations. This one, if you are an enterprise, is the one that normally decides physical or logical. On physical cluster, you can go for you build it, you run it approach for each development team, and each dev team can own their own cluster. While on logical, you need to have a single team or a cross-functional one to manage the cluster. Finally, cost management. In physical isolation, it's business as usual. You tag the VMs with desired cost center and charge based on this. But in logical isolation, it's going to be complex as you need to charge per namespace. The work is still ongoing in the community to make this easier, and we in Azure are helping and following this closely. Once the efforts mature, we will have an implementation for it. So to summarize, there's no one answer that fits all for how many clusters you should use. You will need to think it through. Think of how critical the workload is. Are you cost sensitive? How your organization is structured? Who operates what? And of course, the blast radius. You can end up with a mixture between logical and physical, and that's totally fine, and what we see most of the customers are doing. Then, never use the default namespace for anything close to production. And lastly, resource quotas must be applied even in physical isolation. On the resources, if you are at the beginning of your Kubernetes journey, then please check our conceptual or one-on-one docs. If you are looking for some recommendations and best practices, then we have lined up some great docs for you, which is based on our collective experience from dealing with customers using Kubernetes in Azure for the past years. And lastly, this session and more related sessions can be found in the sessions link. With this, I'm going to end the session. I hope you have enjoyed it, and thanks for watching. Bye-bye.